At one time, there was a community known as the Soghs. They almost monopolized the east-west trade over the Silk Road. Today, they are considered a visionary people who have vanished into the far recesses of history. Large numbers of these figures have been excavated in Chang'an, China, the ancient capital of the Tang dynasty. The figure of the Western man leading a camel is said to be the likeness of a Soghd. Long beards and deep-set eyes. In Soviet Central Asia, we encountered faces that were living replicas of the figure of the camel-leading Western barbarian excavated in Chang'an. Descendants of Soghs, the vanished caravan people, are reported to be living in obscurity in this region. Tajikistan, or the Republic of Tajik in Soviet Central Asia, bordering China in the east and Afghanistan in the south, is situated in the innermost part of Central Asia. Over 90% of the Republic of Tajik is covered by mountains. We have been informed that somewhere in this country are people who speak the Soghdian language even today. The Soghdian language at one time was spoken in the wide-ranging regions from Mongolia in the east to Iran in the west. It was a common language on the Silk Road, but was lost simultaneously with the overthrow of the Soghdians. Dushanbe, the capital of the Republic of Tajik, sits in a small valley formed along the southern foothills of the Jisar Mountains. It now has a population of 520,000, but it was a tiny village with only a few hundred inhabitants before the Russian Revolution. It is a modern city that developed into an industrial and transportation center of southern Central Asia under the Soviet rule. In this city, a large variety of ethnic groups, including Tajiks, Uzbeks, Russians, Tatars and Ossets are living. But the Tajiks alone belong to the Indo-Iranian racial group. And the Tajiks are the most closely related to the Soghs, who belong to the racial group of eastern Iran. Straight nose and deep-set eyes indeed set them apart from other people. A comb maker has a small stall set up on the footway. He is fashioning a piece of mulberry wood into a comb. The combs are used for tidying men's beards. The outdoor tea shop, called Chaikana, is where men stop for relaxation. Here in the city of Dushanbe, no trace of the Soghs we were seeking could be found. The Tajiks say they are descendants of Soghs, but they are Tajiks now. They have never heard Soghdian spoken, nor have they seen Soghdian writing. What they are saying is that the Soghs are now a thing of the past, buried under the ruins. The Soghs inhabited the region known as Soghdian, consisting largely of Samarkand, Bukhara, and Penjikent. They built a community wherever they went and used it as their trading outpost. Remains of such Soghdian communities have been discovered in Zhuiquan, Danhuang, and Hami on the Silk Road inside China. Soghs were outstanding international merchants. In their footprints, we leave Dushanbe and travel along the Vazov River to cross over the Jisar Mountains. It is the road to Penjikent that will lead us to the ruins of the fortress in which the Soghs once flourished. At the western edge of the Republic of Tajik, a city of 13 hectares in area lies buried under a low hill. It is the medieval city of Penjikent, which the Soghs built during the 5th and early 6th centuries. It was a vast oasis linking China to the east and Persia and Byzantine to the west as the east-west trading base on the Silk Road. The excavations at Penjikent have been going on since 1946. One quarter of the inner fortress, surrounded by the outer walls, has been excavated. Ruins of two-story sun-dried brick houses of nobles and houses of common people have been uncovered by excavation. It is said the city contained temples, meeting halls and bazaars, and even a customs house on the western border. This is evidence of the wide-ranging international trade activities which the Soghs were engaged in. Directing the excavation is Professor Marshak of the Institute of Orientalism in Leningrad. According to Professor Marshak, the fall of Penjikent took place in the 8th century under the Arab conquest. The city was put to fire by the Arab forces, and the capital city of Penjikent was razed to the ground so completely as to leave no trace. A superb pillar with an arabesque design carved on it must have been scorched and broken down. After the Arabic conquest, the Soghdian language and the Soghdian writing vanished in Central Asia, and the Arabic language and Arabic writing came into use in their place. Excepting those who escaped into the deeper recesses of the mountains, most of the Soghs became Muslims and ultimately were assimilated into the Turkish people. While large numbers of valuable relics have been excavated at Penjikent, the wall paintings are said to be especially valuable. Even during our coverage work, a wonderful wall painting was discovered at the ruins of a nobleman's mansion. A transparent vinyl sheet is put over the picture and it is very carefully traced. This is one of the most important jobs in the implementation of the restoration project. The wall paintings are everlasting exhibitions of history, preserving images of the lifestyles of those days. Articles of food, clothing, people's features and their gestures painted on the walls tell us about vanished cultures. This painting describes grain transactions. Caravans laden with wheat and barley reportedly used to visit Penjikent from far-off lands like India and Persia. A nobleman with long slitted eyes and slender face is painted in refined detail. The ribbons extending downward from the shoulders are called diadems, which were favorite ornaments of the Persian royalty and nobles under the Sassanid dynasty. The diadem was introduced into Eastern countries, and it is depicted also on the image of a bodhisattva drawn on a piece of linen cloth, which is preserved in the Soghdian temple of Nara. The Soghs seem to have liked decorating inside the house with pictures. Wall paintings are invariably found in most of the houses of wealthy people. Patterns were painted on the lower part of the wall, portraits on the middle part, and gods on the upper part. The walls of all sides were decorated with fine paintings. Feast in the tent apparently is the depiction of a scene at the king's audience. This face of a nobleman bears distinctively oriental features. The vivid yet delicate color tone results from the mixing of rock pigment with plaster. The lapis lazuli is used as the raw material for blue, while mercury compounds or iron oxide provided materials to obtain red. These pictures are evidence of the profound knowledge of painting the Soghs had 1500 years ago. And from these paintings, we can observe the rich lifestyle of the Soghs, who had assimilated the cultures of the East and the West, and surrounded themselves with special products of the various countries. Under the Tang dynasty, Western customs and manners brought via the Silk Road permeated widely through China. It was the Huren cited in Chinese literature who introduced Western cultures. The Huren meant the Western barbarian or the foreigner from the West. The Persians and Soghs were then Western barbarians. The capital city of Chang'an at one time was literally flooded with Western products. Hu Tao, or walnut, Hu Ma, sesame, Hu Suan, garlic, and Hu Chua, cucumber. The ancient Tang history states that the foreigners from Xiyun have brought into Chang'an carpets, glassworks, musical instruments, medical supplies, and many other products. As a result, music of the Western people came to be esteemed. Western foods began to be served on the high society's tables, and men and women began vying with one another in wearing Western-style clothing. The commercial-mindedness inherent in the Soghs made a culture of rich international color. Beyond the vast Iranian plateau, some 5,000 kilometers from Chang'an, along the foothills of the Zagros Mountains, lies Persepolis. Here also remains evidence of visits made by the Soghs. The time is the age of the Achaemenes dynasty, some 1200 years before the Tang dynasty of China. The picture depicts Soghs paying a tribute of sheep to King Darius the Great. Known as born merchants, Soghs took full advantage of their abilities and finally became influential enough to form missions representing a nation. Menandros, the historian of the Eastern Roman Empire, stated, King Diazabal of the Turkish Khaganate in Central Asia sent a mission led by the Soghdian leader Maniach to Persia. The mission was sent to negotiate silk trade with Persia. The negotiation ended in failure, but Maniach succeeded in concluding a treaty of friendship directly with the Eastern Roman Empire. Soghs were most active in the 6th and 7th centuries, and with wealthy merchant Maniach as an example, these merchants had acquired influence powerful enough to control the destiny of a nation. The city of Leninabad is located on the edge of the northern corner of the Republic of Tajik. At one time, this place was called Alexandria Eschata, or the remotest Alexandria. It was the northern extremity of the conquests of Alexander the Great, who gave up any desire to advance further on account of the unpassable ruggedness of the road. Built here in the city of Leninabad is a splendid kolkhoz, or collective farm, that somehow reminds us of the peak of prosperity that the Soghs enjoyed. This gorgeous building, built jointly by 5 collected farms, is claimed to be the largest facility of its kind in Central Asia. Whilst it is known as the Millionaire's Kolkhoz, it constitutes a great cultural palace, containing 100 small halls with a great club hall with a seating capacity for 1,000 people. Numerous ancient documents contain accounts of how the Soghs were wise merchants. Here is what the ancient Tang history states. When a child is born, the Soghs put rock sugar in its mouth and smeared glue on its hands. This was done with the hope that the child, when grown, will have facile command of honeyed words as sweet as rock sugar, and will hold on to money with his hand, even as the glue will bind things together. Being skilled in trade, they vied even for small profits, and there was no place too far for them to go as long as profit was to be made. The Soghs were born merchants, blessed by rock sugar and glue. But people inheriting genuine Soghdian blood, speaking Soghdian language and writing Soghdian words, have vanished from Central Asia amid the turbulent history of ceaseless wars. In the 8th century, Soghs inhabiting Pendikent and its vicinity appear to have abandoned their land under the Arab assaults and escaped deeper into the mountains of Tajik. Their movements have been wrapped in mystery since that time. We, the Silk Road team, made our way to the Zerevshan Mountains in pursuit of the movements of Soghs who have been deserted by history. We came upon the tents pitched by sheep herders on the mid-slope of the Zarafshan Mountains. These people make their living by herding sheep. They bring their sheep to the cool mountainside to let them graze during the summer. Roaming from mountain to mountain in search of grassland is a life typical of Tajik. A summer tent is used as a simple temporary dwelling. Sewing with an old-fashioned hand-operated sewing machine is 18-year-old Nijina. We were told that she is sewing her own wedding dress. She coyly told us that she is going to marry her childhood playmate, a shepherd, when the summer camp is over. A shepherd found a basket woven with willow branches in the Zarafshan mountain. In the basket, there was a piece of wood with strange writing on it. The writing was Soghdian script, set down by the governor Devashtish of medieval Penjikent in Soghdiana sometime in the 8th century. As a result of deciphering the writing, the roots of the Soghs started gradually to come to light. The Soghs escaped to the safety of the Mount Mug, rising from the upper reaches of the Zarafshan River. Large quantities of Soghdian writings have been uncovered in Mount Mug. A total of 81 items of ancient documents written on paper, sheep hide and pieces of wood have been excavated. These included contracts of commercial transactions. Also among them was a letter written by Governor Devashtish and addressed to the Arabian Emir. It is a supplication for the safety of the life of the Soghs exposed to the continuous Arab assaults. We headed for Mount Mug. We were told that it would be difficult to reach without a local guide. This road leads to the upper reaches of the Zarafshan River at an elevation of 2,000 meters. It is the rugged road the Soghs used in their flight some 1,200 years ago. Soghdian documents tell the story. People who lived in Penjikent, children, parents, women and old people, the whole families gathered on Mount Mug. They carried all their valuables with them, gold, silver, silk fabrics and documents related to business contracts. They even brought domestic animals with them for food. The Soghs must have moved silently over this road along the cliff, which is so high that you feel as if you will be sucked into the depths of the ravine. Mount Mug is surrounded by higher mountains on all sides. On the summit of Mug, a mountain fortress known as Kalai Mug, or the Fortress of Mug, came into sight. The foundation of the fortress is formed with natural stones carried up from the dry bed of the Zarafshan River. The outer and inner walls of the fortress are solidly built with sun-dried bricks, and over the rampart one can see all around. It is a strong fortress, skillfully built and making use of the terrain. But the Arab pursuit was relentless. The Fortress of Mug was surrounded by several thousand Arab warriors and was forced to surrender. The king was executed and treasures, gold, silver and everything else were looted. The Soghdian resistance lasted only 2 months and the Soghdian community was destroyed. The 2 months of resistance was the last fighting for the Soghs. Around the mid-slopes of a higher mountain surrounding Mount Mug stretches a green belt in a straight horizontal line. It is the site of a water channel the Soghs built by collecting spring water. Plants that grow along the waterway mark the places where the Soghs once lived. The houses on Mount Mug that were destroyed were two-story structures. The first floor served as a storeroom where foodstuffs were stored. People lived on the second floor. There is no way of visualizing them now, but cooking fireplaces can just be discerned. Soghdian silk uncovered on Mount Mug. As valuable articles were all carried away as spoils, only a small piece was found. The bead crest designed on the tiny piece of silk showed the influence of Persia under the Sassanid dynasty. One of the documents uncovered on Mount Mug was a marriage contract of the 8th century. The man Utigan shall love and respect the woman Chat as wife, and the woman Chat shall do likewise. When husband Utigan takes another woman without the consent of wife Chat in the future, the husband shall pay 30 drachmas to the wife. But if Utigan decides to keep Chat no longer as wife, he shall free her after giving her goods and monies he had received during the married life, in addition to food. Likewise, if Chat decides Utigan is no longer her husband, she shall return the clothes and ornaments to him. Such is the contract made on Tuesday, March the 25th, 710. Thank you. Soghs gave priority to contract, no matter how trivial the affair may have been. It was the wisdom of the Soghdian merchants who made the Silk Road their stage of activity. During the production of this series, we heard that genuine descendants of the Soghs still exist. These people lived in a place called Yagnob, located far deeper into the mountains than Mount Mug. However, we were told that as the mountain pass leading to Yagnob was locked under ice all year round, it would be impossible for us to visit them. Having been told that it would be out of the question to reach Yagnob, where genuine Soghs lived, we were all disappointed. Though we had finally made sure of the existence of the Soghs, who have lived in obscurity for more than 1,000 years, we were beginning to give up hopes of ever meeting them. However, as a result of desperate investigations conducted by the scholars at the Science Academy of the Soviet Union and of the Republic of Tajik, good news reached us. The news was about several men who came down from Yagnob 14 years ago. Still unable to really believe the news, we nevertheless headed for the Zarafabad district, located 150 kilometers west of Leninabad. We were met by grey-bearded old men. This was our first encounter with the Soghs. As we had imagined, their features looked much like those of the figures of Western barbarians leading camels. Though the Soghdian language has been deciphered, the pronunciation of the language has been wrapped in mystery till now. We were finally in a position to hear the Soghdian language with our own ears, and this interview is the first ever to be carried out using the Soghdian language.
よ、そこ、さと。よいしょ。ああ、美味しそうですね。あ。さ、僕、これは全部ここで取れたもんですか。ゼシクセアプロドクセアウバス。
The interview was slow and inevitably difficult, as we had to use four different languages, Japanese, Russian, Tajiki, and Soghdian, and then back the other way. The food before us was all locally produced and was an expression of our host's pleasure in receiving foreign guests. After initial formalities, our interview began.
あの、私たち、ところで外国人のお客さんが見えたのは初めてで、そういう意味でもお客さんとそれから外国の方ということで二重の喜びだと思ってます。ああ。日本にも速度人が
住んでるっていう話を聞いたことがあるんですけど、どうでしょう。あ、ここだも、お、映らない。いや、業者に限り。昔まあそんな噂をしておりました。ということです。ああ。面白いですね。調べてみます。ここにいるね、速度の皆さんの名前と歳聞かせてください。はい、わかりました。プレジソ。わし、いいみゃ、いい、ボーズラスト。
خب
smoke. Send the salt shint. Salt.
This is Mr. Inoyat, who is 78 years old. He used to work on the kolkhoz, or collective farm, but is now retired and lives on a pension.
We explained that we are tracing the ancient Silk Road and wondered if they knew about its history. In Soghdian, they referred to it as Pirobuche.
We went on to ask if they knew of the old customs of putting rock sugar in babies' mouths. Mr. Inayat explained that this was done so that the child would grow up to become a shrewd merchant who would trade skillfully and would lead a sweet and easy life. However, the custom of rock sugar is no longer observed. Later, they told us that they left Yagnob 14 years ago and had been living here since then. Yagnob is situated in a deep valley far up in the mountains at an elevation of between 2,500 and 3,000 meters. They said it was a beautiful place with plenty of water. They told us in their original Soghdian how to say thank you. Nadvik. The Soghs we met still spoke the language, but the writing had been lost. This was due, they say, to the absence of the need for writing in their life in Yagnob. There is no longer the image of Soghs who clasped glue in their hands, spoke honeyed words, concluded contracts in writing, and played the leading role as merchants on the Silk Road. It is said that 3,000 to 4,000 Soghs still live in Yagnob. But now that their habitat has been made known, it will be difficult to maintain the style of living and the language unique to them. We had a feeling that the Soghs will soon mix with other ethnic groups and be assimilated into the modern life prevalent in the Central Asian countries like Tajik, Uzbekistan and Kyrgyzstan. In Central Asia, old history and modern times exist side by side. Frunz in the Republic of Kyrgyz is a modern city built on the ancient Silk Road. Here live people whose blood contains a mixture of races who have lived through a long history. ...50 kilometers east of Frunz, there is a place known as the Red River District. It was here that the site of a ruined Soghdian hamlet was discovered 3 months ago under a mound of soil. Excavation is in progress at the hands of the Kyrgyz Science Academy. Numerous urns called ossuaries have been excavated from this site of a hamlet known as Krasnaya Reka or Red River. As the social status of the person buried becomes higher, workmanship on the engraving of the urn becomes finer. The design showing two priests lighting the sacred fire of the altar is evidence of the fact that the Soghs buried here were Zoroastrians. This design, also found on Persian coins, is said to be the most typical of the Zoroastrian designs. Some Soghs were Buddhists, Nestorians, Christians, and Manichaeans, but the majority are said to have believed in Zoroastrianism. We were told that this was the first time that so many finely made urns had been found. They must have exposed the dead bodies to the winds or to the birds to feast on, collected the bones into the ossuary and buried them here. This place was a Soghdian cemetery. Soghdian wall painting excavated at Penjikent. A beautiful woman is elegantly playing the harp. A reminder of the glory of the Soghs that was. Soghdian merchants transported all kinds of goods. Silk, spices, ceramic ware, gems and precious stones. And along with these things, music, art and religions. The Soghs were people who created the history of the Silk Road, and those very Soghs now lead an obscure life in the remotest recesses of Central Asia.